How y'all doing? All right, you're in for a treat, I hope. If you leave early, I won't be embarrassed. Pastor Isaac asked Rebecca and I to fill in while they do some family business, a funeral that they have coming up out of town. So we gladly, I guess, accepted. So anyways, we put together a very different but very similar message. We're going to tie some of this into the teaching that Isaac has been doing on Saul and Samuel. And you'll understand it when we get to that part. But anyways, my darling wife, she's responsible for like 90% of this. She's very organized, makes notes, knows what she's going to say. And I'm the wing it. Yeah. Say, I'm going to get a download when I get up there. So anyways, get ready for a load.
So I think we should probably just say a quick prayer before we get started. I know I need it, and I'm guessing Bryan could benefit from it too. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this church body. It is wonderful to be here tonight to share some of the insights that you have given to us. And Lord, we ask that you let us speak only what you want us to say, and let it minister to those that are here this evening and those that are maybe watching on Facebook. Lord, I thank you for the dedication of all the people here. Thank you for the leadership of the pastors and the staff. And Lord, we just bring you all the glory and honor tonight. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. So, let's see. You have your handout in front of you, and we're going to have probably some of the slides. You may or may not see them in your handout. Don't worry about that. So I'll try to help to guide you through, and Kelly's going to help me with the slides in the back. She'll do a great job. So I think we're ready to go to the next slide. So this is kind of an outline of what we're going to try to cover tonight. We're going to start with a very brief introduction of Bryan and I, and then we'll talk about me, all of our favorite topics, right? And then God and me, the journey, God, my spouse, and me, fighting and winning the battle, and then final tips and takeaways. So, next slide. So, quick introduction. Bryan and I have been married for 41 years. Amazing, right? Yep. And in a few weeks, it's going to be 42. And when Isaac asked us to teach tonight, he asked us to team teach. Well, Bryan and I have never team taught before. So it should be interesting to see how this goes. But we're hoping to give you some insight into who all of us are as individuals, who God made us to be, our relationship with him and our spouse. And hopefully, there'll also be some things that relate to our relationship with others, our siblings, our parents, that sort of thing. So these pictures, the one that's 1982, that's when we were married, that was taken in Michigan. And then the one under the 2017, that's my niece and her husband's wedding, and we were 35 years married that year. So, yes, we do change over the years. So let's go to the next slide. So our favorite topic, me, and me. And kind of similar to the way God is three persons in one, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, we are three-part beings as well. We are spirit, we are soul, and we are body. That spirit man is the spiritual part of us. And when we're born again, it becomes alive. But if we're not born again, it dead. Like dead, dead. Now, that's God's way. So you see the little, it says God's way underneath the spirit. So you'll see how these three kind of tie together here in a minute. The body, that's the physical part, right? It's seen, it's alive, as long as we're in this earth. And that's the part that says, however I'm directed to go, that's the way I'm going to go. The body doesn't call the shots. But that next one, that soul, that solical, that one likes to call the shots.
Yeah.
That's where the mind, the will, and the emotions are, right? We can't see it, but it's very much alive.
Yeah. Our body is like a one-year-old. It just wants to be fed, to be clean, to be, you know, it wants what it wants. It's totally self-centered.
That's true. Yes, definitely. There's a couple of scripture references. Genesis 1:27, God created us in his image, male and female, he created us. And also 1 Thessalonians 5:23 mentions how we are spirit, soul, and body. So those three components are in that scripture. So let me ask this question. Has anybody ever had a situation where your body did something that you fully unexpected that it was going to happen? So when you went to the doctor and they would hit your knee, right? Once it happened a couple of times, you knew it was going to happen, but you didn't make it happen. But most of the time, like Bryan said, that body is just going to do what it's told to do. If you're born again, the spirit's directing you through your soul to your body. If you're not born again, that soul's in control. And even when you're born again, believe it or not, sometimes that soul decides, I'm going to do it my way. And that body does exactly what the soul tells it to do. Let's go take a look at the two-party relationship between God and me. So there's two conditions. We just talked about the spirit is either alive or it's dead. When it's dead, you have the gap. Not the store, the gap. You have this gap between you and God, right? There's a chasm between the two. The spirit's dead, and you know what? That soul and body has cracks. I think Pastor used the word brokenness this past Sunday, right? And when we get born again, that gap goes away, and all of a sudden there's this direct connection. Our spirit comes alive, but guess what? Those cracks, that brokenness, a lot of that's still there. It takes time for those cracks to get healed. So think about the cracks in your life. I know for me, hurts, abuse, sickness, addiction, disappointments, unmet expectations, betrayal, losses, disease. I don't know about you, but when I got born again, those did not all go away.
My cracks are showing. And let me if you don't know these little circles and circles, it's called a Zen or a.
Oh, that's right. I forgot that.
Yeah. It's called a Venn diagram. And God does everything in threes. You know, there's body, soul, and spirit. That's the way God functions, and that's the way my brain functions. And what we've done is we've taken, you know, the body, soul, and the spirit, and taken the kind of the same approach when we're unsaved. It's our body. It's in Egypt. We have no connection with God. We're enslaved to what our mind and our body is doing. And that page you see right there, when we get born again, a lot of teaching says, oh, you're going to go from Egypt to the promised land. No. You just went to the desert. You're knocking at the door of going into the promised land, but you're not there yet.
So actually, your spirit does, right? That spirit part of you that's connected to God, that immediately passes go and goes directly to the promised land, right? It's as perfect as it's ever going to be. All of Jesus, all of God is in that spirit part of you. But the rest of you, like Bryan says, it ain't there.
And what happens, the reality is, on the next slide, is we go into the wilderness. And there are several reasons why God had us going into the wilderness. But I have to start with, we always had this vision of Egypt, of everyone like making bricks and hauling big blocks and being whipped on the back and stuff. That is not true. There were people who worked in Pharaoh's palace. There were accountants and bookkeepers and surveyors. They had a society. They had priests. They had laws. They had elders. It was a total society. And a lot of people had it pretty darn good in Egypt. I mean, they were living the life in Egypt. Even though they were in bondage, they were pretty comfortable. And it's interesting, when Moses says, I'm going to deliver you, everybody was all excited. And, you know, we're going to go into the promised land. And I didn't even notice until I went back and studied. Moses told them when they were still in Egypt, you're going to have to face all these ites. There's an enemy that you're going to have to fight. But they're like, yeah, let's go. Well, when they got out there after a few days, they found out this is not so easy. And it's like, we got fed every day, and we had a place to sleep, and, you know, it wasn't so bad. We kind of want to go back. This wandering around the desert and eating manna and stuff gets old really, really fast. And God has something else in mind. He says, I'm going to give you, there's like five books in the Bible that cover nothing but law. I was thinking, there's Exodus, and then in the book of Exodus, they go into the promised land. No, there's Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and then you get to Joshua. There's all these books. They're all laws. I mean, it's like boring stuff. I mean, you want to, you know, if you have insomnia, this is great stuff to read and thinking, oh, my God. So they had to endure that for 40 years before they could go into the promised land. And then none of the people who were over the age of 20 went into the promised land.
Except for Joshua and Caleb.
For Joshua and Caleb. The rest wanted to go back to Egypt. They were like, it was easier back in Egypt. And then, you know, it's interesting too, when Moses sent out the 12 spies, they went up on the west side of the Jordan River, where the land is fertile and it was beautiful, and they brought back these big clumps of grapes and all this stuff. And they're saying, oh, but there's giants. And the people are like, no, we don't want to deal with the giants. No, 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 no. And Moses already told them they were going to have to fight. So 40 years later, did they take that same route that the 12 spies put? No. They went up the east side of the Jordan River in the wilderness. So they didn't even do what Joshua and Caleb says, just go up there and fight them, you can take it. And God kept promising, go this way. Nope, we're going to do it our way.
So as you can see from the diagram, we've labeled Egypt as kind of like our body, which is lawless. It does what it's told to do. The wilderness representing the soul, there is a law. But the destination, the place you want to go, the promised land, that's the Spirit and that's grace. So if you can see the arrow at the top that's going from Egypt all the way to the promised land, that's like swimming upstream. It takes work. Lots of work. Every day work. Right? Over and over and over. Sometimes, like Bryan says, it's like, am I ever going to get it? Am I ever going to get this right? But if we don't keep swimming, what happens? That's that arrow at the bottom that's going back the other direction. It's floating downstream. If you don't swim, you're going to go with the current. And that's not where we want to go. The scripture references Philippians about it taking work. That's the one that talks about working out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it's God who works in you, both to will, which is in the soul, and to do, which is in the soul and in the body, his good pleasure. But if you take that easy route, where it's got the lazy river there, you just lay back and go with the flow, you're getting wet, but you ain't swimming. That Matthew 26:41 says, watch and pray lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
I always get these word pictures again, Venn diagram types of things. And in the wilderness, the Lord showed me, I call it the three T's. They receive the law, you have training. People in the military would understand this. You get trained, then they test you. And if you fail the test, they train you some more. And they test you. And when you finally pass the test, then they can trust you to have an assignment. But if you don't go through that training, God can't trust you with an assignment. And we fail. We're just like, man, this is too hard. I'm done training, and I just quit. And God can't use us. He can't trust us. You know, he can't put you in charge of a ministry and, you know, 2 years down the road say, I'm done with this stuff. This is crazy. And, we can do it in the flesh, but that's not the productive way that God wants to do it. And we're all guilty of that. I mean, this, like I say, you all that were in the military realize that you train and train and train, then they test you. And God's doing that to us. Are we faithful to do the hard stuff where we can get an assignment? And it doesn't mean the assignments are easy, but you're prepared for it.
The ladies might remember we talked about how the trying of your faith works patience. And when we learn patience through those trials of our faith grows and our patience grows. So this little diagram looks pretty straightforward, right? Really nice and pretty. But I think the next slide after that is what our daily life generally looks like.
I keep telling Rebecca, I spend at least 20 minutes a day in the promised land. The rest of the time, I'm either in Egypt or I'm out in the desert. But, you know, I'm working on it.
There are arrows going every which direction. Some of them, you're not making any progress at all. You just keep going around and around and around, right? So Bryan and I learned a little bit about each other just putting this training together. I'm thinking, oh, well, you know, we will put the PowerPoint together and we'll talk about, you know, what the scriptures we want to make sure we talk about and who's going to say what. And it'll be so organized, you know, we'll have it done like 2 weeks in advance. Not a chance.
What's wrong with my handwritten Venn diagrams? Out of a spiral notebook.
I mean, we've been married for 41 years. We dated for less than a year before we got married. But you would think by now, right, I would know what to expect from him. No. And when he doesn't do what I expect, what happens to me?
The feeling's mutual. Can we play this?
Yeah. So we have a little clip, and I think Caleb's got this ready for us. You may have heard of Keith Green. He wrote a song, and it was actually the title of an album called So You Want to Go Back to Egypt. Now, all of the lyrics are not on the screen. If you want to look it up on your phone and read the lyrics, or if you can hear the music, it's pretty funny. And we thought it's very fitting for our crazy journey that we go through on a daily basis. Are you ready, Kayla? Okay.
So you want to go back to Egypt, where it's warm and secure. I'm sorry you bought the one-way ticket when you thought you were sure. You wanted to live in the land of promise, but now it's getting so hard. I'm sorry you're out here in the desert instead of your own backyard. But travel, and we sure travel a lot. Cause it's hard to keep your feet from moving when the sand gets so hot. And in the morning it's manna hot cakes, we snack on manna all day. And they sure had a winner last night for dinner, flaming manna souffle. Well, we once complained for something new to munch. Manna again? Oh. Nana.
Nana, Patty?
Banana bread.
When we get born again, we don't go into the promised land immediately. I mean, we go into the wilderness where we learn about God and he teaches us. And we also learn that going into the promised land is full of ites. And you have to fight to go in and stay in the promised land. And unfortunately, I think there's a lot of teaching out there. It's just, oh, you just get born again and read your Bible and presso. It's great. It's wonderful. But I can guarantee you, there's a lot of people sitting in this room, they're going like, I'm not going anywhere. My Christianity is stale. And the reason is, we're not doing the right thing. We're not taking it seriously. You have to study the scriptures, not read the scriptures. People say, oh, read your Bible every day. When I was in school, I read my homework, but I didn't study my homework. And then when the test time came and I got my paper back, I'm going, oh, this is not so good. And it took me a while to learn how to study. It takes work. You have to think about what you're studying. And the scriptures are the same way. You read them, and then you go like, okay, now what is it saying? I heard what it said, but what is it saying? You have to go down a level, and you only get that when you study. You don't get enlightened unless you study. But anyways, I just wanted to make that point that most of us, you know, I think of Isaac's teaching of Saul and Samuel. We're all Sauls. Whether we want to admit it or not, we've got this in control, and every now and then I'll go to God or I'll go to Samuel and I'll get a word, and I'm like, okay, do I really want to do that? Well, maybe next time. Or we just go do our own thing. So we're all Sauls, whether we want to admit it or not. And that's the point that I wanted to make. And the thing is, for us to get out of the wilderness, we have to study. We have to stay in the Word. We have to be in teaching. We have to pray. And it's not easy. We get weary. At least I get weary anyway. So I just like, oh, do I have to do this today? But that's just, again, we still have a body in a soul that has cracks in it. We have a perfect spirit, but we're still broken people. And the quicker we realize that, and the only way for us to get better is we have to work. We have to fight the fight.
And work is one of those four-letter words. It sure doesn't feel good, but it produces good. So up to this point, everything we've talked about is applicable on an individual basis. We haven't talked one word about marriage yet, but we're about to. So we saw how messy it was, right, as an individual, with all those arrows going every which way, right, between the body and the soul and the spirit. But when we go to the next slide, not only do we have that going on with us, we've got that going on with our spouse. And we're trying to relate to one another. And we're trying to maintain our relationship with God. I mean, it's a miracle that people get married. And it's an even greater miracle that they stay married. So the basics, one man, one woman, we all know that. Each person in this diagram is born again. Now, that's not the case in every marriage. In fact, there's probably a lot of marriages where neither one is born again. So you can just take that God circle and just ignore it, right? They're just going back and forth with each other. That's all they have. Fortunately, those that are born again, we have God to help us. And he is the head of the marriage. That's why I put him at the top, right? He's the top dog. He's the head of the relationship. And as each person draws closer to God, you draw closer to each other. So I gave you Ecclesiastes 4, 9 and 12. So verse 9, two are better than one, right? If you can get a man and woman together, they have a good reward for their labor. But verse 12 says, though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. So when you've got God with the two of you, you're much, much stronger. Now, your next slide has a boatload of scriptures, and no, we're not going to go through all these, but I arranged them so that you can look at the scriptures that apply to everybody, all of us, right? Then there's a section that applies to the wives, and there's a section that applies to the husbands. And what you'll see for most of them is they're coming from the same section. Ding, 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 ding. So the first one, that 2 Corinthians 4:7, that just says we all have this treasure in earthen vessels. Because later on there's a scripture that talks about how husbands are to dwell with their wife as the weaker vessel. That doesn't mean he's not a vessel too, right? They're both vessels. So if you get a chance, when you go through these, try to pair up the 1 Peter ones, there's three, and pair up the Ephesians ones, there's three of those, and pair up the Colossians ones. So you can see that even though there are specific scriptures to husbands and wives, there's a lot that talks to everybody.
And another thing too, people say, what is heaven? What's our spiritual life supposed to look like? And the simplest way I can put it, is scriptural, is to love the Lord God with all your heart and all your soul, and your neighbor as yourself. That is a challenge. And manifest the fruits of the Spirit. And our last page, we have some tips to kind of how we do that. We have to be mindful all the time of what we're thinking and what our attitude is. Like I say, when I get behind the steering wheel and get on the roads in Fort Collins, my spirituality goes. And so I'm telling myself like every 10 seconds, be cool, Bryan. Walk in love, you know, love them. Pray for them when they sit there at the green light. You know, just, and we get better at it if we keep exercising our mind and our emotions, we get better at it.
And that's one of those examples where I'm just like him. So if we're in the car together, I don't say a word. Because I know if I'm in the
She's worse than I am.
I'm doing the same thing.
We feed on each other.
So Kelly, if we can go back to the fighting, winning the battle, the next one after that. There we go. Okay. So each of us is in a battle for our life. Every day. All the time. We have an enemy that will not quit. He wants to take us down. He wants to take us out. But guess what? He's not him. My enemy is not my husband. The battle is won or lost in the soul. Right? It's not the body, it's not the spirit, it's the soul. It's that nasty will, mind, and emotions that wants its own way. So, just a couple questions. How do you see your partner? As a soldier fighting with you or against you? If you stand back to back and fight together, you can defeat the devil. Why back to back? Because that way you've got 360 degrees that you can cover. You've got each other's backs, and you can hit the devil no matter what way he comes. But as soon as you turn toward each other to fight, that's all you see as your enemy. And the devil wins. And we don't want that to happen at all, ever. But we do have to work at it, like Bryan said. So I've listed a few things here about how you can help your partner fight the battle, right? We've talked about what you need to do, but how do you help your partner fight? Pray for and with him or her. Both. With and for. Actively listen to the words when they speak. And listen to the heart. So listen to the attitude behind the words. Right? We hear, there's a lot more going on than we really pay attention to with our spouse. We know them so well. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, there's a lot more there if we listen. Over time, you're going to gain a lot of understanding, knowledge, and wisdom. Pastor's teaching on wisdom right now. Knowledge, understanding, and wisdom. And then you'll know how to best minister to them. Each of us is an individual. What works for Bryan doesn't work for Bruce. What works for Bruce doesn't work for Ed. Right? We're all individuals. And then the scripture reference, most of you probably know this about God's battle armor. If you read through that, it'll tell you all the different pieces you need to put on so you can fight the battle against our spiritual enemy, not our spouse. So as Bryan already let you know, final tips and takeaways. There's nothing new probably in most of what we've presented tonight. It's probably a refresher, reminder. Yes, I know those scriptures. But it doesn't hurt to go repeat things, right? So what we have on the end here, first of all, do the stuff you know to do. Just do it. Bryan talked about how we need to be mindful of who we are. We need to pray, including listening to God. I was so blessed during the ladies' Bible study when Norma said, I've been praying, and it's like, I really need to listen better. I'm like, thank you, Jesus. That's exactly right, because he knows it all. He knows it all about us, about our spouse, about the situation, about the devil. He's got the whole thing if we'll just listen. And of course, read and study our Bible. And of course, attend church and go to Bible study and go to teaching. We know to do those things. We just need to do them.
One of the things I do to try to keep joy, and it's hard to do in this world, is to maintain love and joy. And what I do, this is kind of a mental exercise that I go through, is like I have got the Super Bowl winning lottery ticket in my wallet. I can't cash it in yet, but I've got the winning ticket in my wallet. Can you imagine how your attitude would change if you went to work knowing that you had the winning lottery ticket in your wallet? Your view on life, all the cares and worries you had are like, they're gone. I have got it. I haven't cashed it in yet, but I know I got it, and someday I'm going to cash it in, and I'm a winner. And that's the way we are as believers. We're winners here on earth, but we've got the winning ticket into heaven. And if we can keep that in mind, saying, yeah, I'm gonna let this pain and suffering and frustration in this world get to me, I'm going to think about that winning ticket.
Amen. Amen. So the last section here is to spend some time learning about the stuff we don't know, right? So there's all the stuff we do know, And we can do that, or we can choose not to, to our own detriment. But there's also things we still don't know. So the ones I've listed here, like, what are the cracks in my life? Where is that brokenness? Where is there a need for more healing in me? And be sensitive to that. Talk to your spouse about that. When you say XYZ, that really hurts me, but I don't think it's because you've said it. I think it's because there's something in my past that makes that touchy to me. Who are my trusted friends? If you don't have some trusted friends, build some relationships. You need people that you can talk to that will speak truth into your life, that will listen when you're really going through a tough time, that they're trusted. They have proven, like Bryan said, they've gone through the training, they've gone through the testing, I can trust them. They'll be there to help me. And then last but not least, how do I honor and love my spouse as God intends? I don't take marriage counseling from Facebook. Because I know that's not what God intends. So before we close in prayer, we've got just a few minutes. Does anybody have any questions? Does anybody have something that we presented that just doesn't quite make sense? They'd like to learn a little bit more, understand a little bit more? And if not tonight, you know who we are now, right? We're pretty approachable. There are times when I'm having a rough day, and you can tell by the look on my face I'm not approachable.
No comment.
But I just also want to thank all of you for being so patient with us tonight, because this really was a stretch for us to do this together, and you've been wonderful.
Yeah, and we're all on that journey. We all, I hate to say it, we spend more time in the wilderness than we do with the promised land. But our goal is to get transformed, to grow and mature into, you know, like Rebecca was saying, iron sharpens iron, have friends that we can fellowship, and how do we get through difficult situations? We all need that, whether we want to admit it or not, because we're all imperfect.
Amen. Yeah. Amen to that.
Let me close this in prayer. If y'all have any questions, feel free to come up. Father, we thank you and praise you for this evening. We thank you for the teaching. We thank you that it can reach the hearts of all those who are here, that they can hear it and understand. They can understand why they feel frustration and why they feel that there's no victory in their life, Father. We show them that they're not the only ones in the battle, but you're there for them. We're here for one another. We're here to grow together, to walk in the fullness that you have for us, that we can walk with love and joy in the society that we have, Father. Jesus. We just thank you that we have ears to hear, Father, that we can be your children, Father, and be a light to the just dark world, Father. We just thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, everybody.